thanks for joining us today. My name is Sandra Wick. I am the Crop Production Agent with the Post-Rec District of K-State Research and Extension. Today I have a special guest with me, Dr. Stu Duncan. He is our Northeast Region Agronomist. So, Stu, why don't you start and tell us a little bit about what your role is for producers and extension agents.
Okay, Sandra, thank you for the kind introduction. Basically, as a regional agronomist, my main task is to help the county and district extension agents with their agronomic programming and actually planning and programming of any type is what I basically do. Plus, then I have an applied research program, which is the real basic. It's not basic research in the lab, but it's very simple applied production techniques that we can use either as a demonstration in the field with the county agent, because mine generally stem from questions the county agents get, and then if I hear it two or three times, we start developing a program with those agents to find a cooperator, and away we go, and we usually just impose something on part of that field, and we try to get yields, and the county agents can use those locally, and it's local information generated by them for their cooperators, and that's what I see my job as.
Okay, anyway. And there's regional agronomists around the state, and we have one in Northwest, and we're in the process of maybe hiring in some of those positions at this time. So you're not all filled at this time. You're not all complete. So
no, Dr. Lucas Hagout and Colby has got Northwest Kansas, and I've got Northeast Kansas, and we both have the
Southeast
rest of the state too.
Yes. There you go. Well, I know during the months of January and February, there's lots of educational programs that K-State Research and Extension does, not only in the agronomy side, which we are, but also in the livestock side and industry as well. So we're just kind of this week gearing up, and we're doing some soybean schools, and there'll be some corn production schools, some sorghum production schools. So why don't you tell a little bit about, maybe if you could tell producers one thing on their fertility management in soybeans, what would that be?
Sandra, I would tell them to, they need to know what they've got in their field to manage it, to help manage for the whole crop, not just this year, but in coming years. They need to know from a soil test, and an accurate soil test with reputable results, that they can work with you or their supplier, however they want to do it. But I'd recommend working with Sandra, quite frankly, if I was in the Post-Rec District, simply because you have the experience with those fields. But pH is just critical out here. In the traditional soybean growing areas of Kansas, we would run into low pHs more often. But as we come west of the Flint Hills and further north in the state, north of 54 Highway, for instance, our pHs will tend to go down as we've more intensely crop in our soils. More row cropping now than we have done corn, higher fertility rates with nitrogen means we're going to acidify that soil a little more quickly over time.
Right, and I've seen in the last, 15, 20 years, the soil pHs have tended to go down, and just because of our high intensity with fertility management.
Multiple crops.
There you go.
And multiple applications, and we don't get those yields without that nitrogen. But phosphate is very critical there, too. Mm-hmm. And in soybeans in particular, are very high users of phosphate and potash, things that you probably didn't see very many deficiencies of in the past. You need to keep an eye on, and that high, and as our pH goes down, that becomes more of an issue. Plus, if you drive your pH down below 6 very far, the rhizobia, the bacteria that infect the soybean roots or invade them and produce the nodules that produce the nitrogen, a big chunk of the nitrogen that the soybean crop's going to use, they don't survive at pHs of low, about 5/8 where they, but they slow down as that pH gets lower. You might have seen that last slide I used from Ken Kelly, even though that's in southeast Kansas. That soybean responds to that pH being up above 6 to 7 very, very rapidly.
Right. So we know that there's lots of places that producers can get their soil tested. So it's not really critical, or we're not advocating one over the other one. We just want you to get your soil test.
That's right.
So you can get it at K-State Research and Extension. You can get it through your local co-op. But getting representative samples is critical. So like you said, you're going to be able to know what's out there in your field so you can manage accordingly. So we have some soil testing equipment in our office that you can get. There's a traditional probe that you use your body weight to get down there and get a core samples, and not just one core. You know, we're talking 15 to 20 different cores.
Absolutely.
In about, a 40-acre patch, and maybe something that's kind of what we
recommend.
If it's fairly
uniform, you know, you can zone for a zone if you got a quarter section out there. But our soils are a lot more variable than many people think they are.
Right.
It may be the same series and the same type, but mm-hmm. it's different.
Right. And soil depth is very important too. Now, you were talking phosphorus.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking 0 to 6 inches is typically what we recommend for our soil depth. Whereas nitrogen, which we really don't talk nitrogen that much in soybeans, but we're talking 18 to 24 inch depth is what we really recommend.
Right.
pH is more the 0 to 6 inch depth, you know, is what we're talking about. So getting the correct depth is important too, or you're not going to get a real accurate picture of what's going on up there in your field.
And many of your cooperators no-till too. And if
exactly.
I'm no-tilling, Dorvar Ruiz Diaz, Dr. Ruiz Diaz, who runs our soil testing lab, and would usually be doing the fertility presentation. He will the recommendation is 0 to 3 inches for the pH and the phos now.
Hmm.
And even, I would say even the potash, because it does not, the K does not infiltrate very far either,
okay.
So unless
okay.
we're placing it deep.
Right.
And I would take a 6-inch sample and split it, quite frankly, 0 to 3 and 3 to 6.
Okay. And typically out here, when you get more west or central Kansas, we typically don't have as much of an issue with potash or potassium, whereas you guys do maybe in the northeast part of the state. But it's not necessarily that we don't, so the only way you're going to know is that you soil test. We also have another piece of equipment out here that we've done. It's like a drill and a auger bit that can...
Mm-hmm.
Where you use a bucket and there's a hole in the bottom of that bucket, so that is available for checkout in a lot of our district offices, either in Beloit, Lincoln, Mankato, Osborne, or Smith Center. You can go to our website as well and get lots of information as well. There's lots of information publications available on K-State's webpage and on our Post-Rock Extension webpage. We mentioned a soybean management 2020. It talks about the fertility management there. The other crops also have an updated publication for each of the crops,
yes.
Whether it be corn, whether it be sorghum, all of those have some management features in that publication
mm-hmm.
every year that is updated as well.
And we should have a wheat one too. I think we're revising that one right now.
Okay. Again, we'd like to thank you for joining us today. My name is Sandra Wick, the crop production agent with the Post Rock Extension District, and Dr. Stu Duncan, our Northeast Region agronomist. So please check out our Facebook and our webpage, which is www.postrock.ksu.edu, and we will visit with you later.